Welcome everyone, and thank you for joining us today in our presentation. My name is Jeff Cottle, and I'm a product manager for BASF Professional and Specialty Solutions. Also with us is our presenter for the session today and occasional invaders, Dr. Jason Meyers, who is a senior technical service representative. We'll have time after Jason's presentations for your questions, which you can type into our Q&A box anytime during the presentation. As a way of thanking you for joining us today, we will have a drawing later for three prizes. One participant will receive a backpack sprayer and two more will receive a Yeti half-gallon jug. The names of the winners will be included in the follow-up email to participants later this week that will include the link to our recording of this presentation. We hope you will share the link with others in your office or keep it handy for reference. You will also be able to find it on our website at any time. Through the Perimeter Pro series, we talk about the keys for the game, which includes a commitment to an IPM strategy, choosing the right product rotation, and building a bullpen of trusted specialists. Commit to an IPM strategy refers to start with an inspection and employee exclusion strategies to deny pest access to the home, address habitats where pests can hide and breed, use physical and mechanical chemical controls, choose the right starting rotation, refers to select your star players based on pest pressure and seasonality, rotate between your start players based on their modes of action, tailor your plans to reflect the frequency of service provided. Build a bullpen of trusted specialists refers to be great with a bullpen of targeted products to troubleshoot tough situations. Choose products that are reliable and easy to use. Know when it's time to make critical substitution. When we look at the left side of this slide, we see our dilutable products. The dilutables are the go-to products when we talk about perimeter pest control. Here we have Terminator SC as the foundation. Terminator SC is an industry-leading solution for use around structures for outdoor pests such as ants, wasps, spiders. It's also a non-repellent product with genuine transfer effect, and the active ingredient is fipronil. Alpine WSG, which is an outdoor spectrum, non-repellent with horizontal transfer effect. It has very flexible label, including application in food handling areas, and the active ingredient is dinoterophen. Fendona CS, control-released insecticide, which is a repellent product with long-lasting microcap technology, which also makes it non-irritating to the skin during application. This is a fantastic product for perimeter treatment and mosquito control. The active ingredient is alpha cypermethrin. On the right side of the screen, we look at the bullpen products. These are specialty top quality products, and you're going to learn about these products during a series of seminars. Here we have foam products like Terminator foam, pressure art products such as PT Fendona, bait products such as Advanced Ant Bait, Mother Earth, CS Sapphire Ant Bait, and dust products such as Alpine D Dust Insecticide. As I mentioned earlier, please type your questions in where you see the Q&A icon at the bottom of your screen. We will start the Q&A after Jason finishes the presentation. And with that, I'll turn it over to you, Jason.
All right. Thank you, Jeff. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us. I hope everybody's having an awesome day. All right. Okay. We are going to talk about a number of different items for occasional pests. We're gonna end up focusing on probably three pests in particular. Maybe we get to another one or two, kind of depends on how I talk. and whether or not I start talking a whole lot about some particular subject. But we're going to focus on the outside of a home, and then we're going to get into a number of different perimeter applications and types and reasonings. And then we're going to get into those three pests that I'd mentioned. One of those is brown marmorated stink bug, which many of you have gotten used to over the last few to several years, depending on where you're at in the country. A brand new one with spotted lanternfly that is moving about the country fairly quickly. And then we will get into spiders. And it's not something we always think about or talk about as part of occasional pests, but really by definition, they are. And so we're going to discuss some pretty interesting data that most people have not seen previously. And so throughout this presentation profile, we'll have a number of the products sprinkled in that Jeff mentioned earlier, and how they affect positively the outcomes that you're looking for occasional pests. We're going to be focusing on the summer type pests for occasional invaders, as we see the brown rind stink bug float into your screen. Okay, first off, we want to talk about a little bit of safety. So with anything that is soap related, soap kills bacteria and viruses. The FDA has noted that pretty much any type of soap, AKA any type of soap, actually kills all sorts of different viruses, bacteria, and the like. Not all viruses and bacteria, some of them are a little bit more difficult, but for the most part, they include every single type of soap out there, including COVID, every type of soap kills off all sorts of viruses and bacteria, including COVID, okay? Within this instant soap and water canister, you can have up to about 100 applications, depending on how big you create your foam each time. But if you hold it to about a golf ball size, you'll get about 100, a little over 100 applications. So all sorts of hand sanitizers out there. Some of them have a little bit more information on killing bacteria and the like. But the FDA has noticed that there's a number of different behavioral reactions to the hand sanitizers that people have, and therefore it can prevent people from using it properly. When they don't use it properly, then they don't normally clean their hands thoroughly enough to kill off bacteria and viruses, at least consistently. So what they've noticed is that soap, people will use it in a more consistent manner and for a longer time period, and therefore they end up cleaning off and killing a lot more bacteria and virus that way. So as we see here with this particular video over to the right, you can notice that we are creating a golf ball sized foam, right? So that's your goal. And then you just simply brush it around your hands, okay? And then you can let that dry. You do it for about 20 seconds. That's why they always talk about saying your ABCs, right? So some of you may not still have your ABCs memorized, okay? But about going for about 20 seconds or so. So once you're done there, you can either rinse off your hands with water, or you can use paper towel, throw in the trash, okay? It's pretty simple, okay? So either way, you're removing any sort of contaminants that are on your skin or on the outside of your skin. So you think of soap as killing viruses and bacteria directly, and it's also emulsifying or pulling off of the surface the contaminants. So whether it be dirt or bacteria, viruses, whatever, they're coming up off the surface, they're emulsifying, and then you can take them off with either water or paper towel. So anyhow, thus ends your lesson on cleaning your hands for today. So one of the things that we like to discuss is the innovation pipeline within BASF. It is really quite amazing, the amount of products that are going to be coming to market, and there's even more than what is listed on this slide here, especially in the next 2 or 3 years. Overall, our ag products division, which includes us, spends about $3.8 million per day on research and innovations and all sorts of bottom line expenditures that enable us to create a huge amount of new potential products. And you can see here listed out in just the next couple of years, we're gonna have some really cool products, and some of them are going to absolutely amaze you over the next, probably next year, being the most greatest likelihood for some of these really neat products that are gonna be coming to market. And we'll start talking to you more about that in the near future when it is appropriate. All right. One of the things that I want you to keep in mind is a quote from Bobby Corrigan, and it really has a lot to do with not just rodents, which are considered occasional pests, but also occasional insect pests. The more you know, the more you see. So the more you can educate yourself, the more you can think about the area in which you are trying to control, what the homeowner or the management has told you about the ongoings of the facility, you can take that knowledge, couple it with things like today's seminar or all the other things that you've read about or learned or your experience level. The more you know, the more you can see. And sometimes just sitting still and watching is really helpful, okay? All right, so perimeter pest versus occasional invader. We're gonna kind of define, start the definition of what is perimeter and what is occasional. So you can think of a perimeter pest as a primary target. They can do damage or harm or some sort of annoyance to the homeowner, or to the management. They typically will complete their life cycle inside somehow, okay? Or they can, they're capable of it. The control techniques are very specific to those pest groups, like ants, cockroaches, spiders, and the like, occasional invaders, secondary target usually, okay? They're not around all year. They're come out during a certain period of time. They typically don't do damage, but they're big annoyance factors. Some of them will do some damage. You know, you can think about Asian lady beetles, and the chemicals that they exude can stain different types of fabric or surfaces and the like. So sometimes they'll do damage, but most of the time it's not a big deal. This is just becomes a tremendous and sudden annoyance. They typically do not complete their life cycle indoors. Most of their life is had outside of the structure, and then they're seeking out the structure for some sort of protection, okay? So whether it's from the elements or whatever, right? Those control techniques are typically more generalized because they're not always gonna know where they're gonna be coming in from. Although something like, say, a cluster fly are going to be going into the south side of buildings where generally the sunlight is the greatest, okay? So that's going to be the warmest part of the building. They're going to move to there. And so sometimes you can zero in on your applications. And examples are numerous, but all sorts of different types of insects, arthropods, and that includes all sorts of different types of behaviors, especially how to get into a structure. And we'll get into some of those. Occasional invaders, more specifically, normally they're found outdoors. Sometimes they come indoors and become a problem. Sometimes it is our fault. So you look at this example here in the picture of springtails. Typically, if springtails become an issue, we have done something wrong at the structure, not meaning PMPs, but the homeowner. The homeowner's done something wrong. The soil's above grade, or they put way too much mulch in and the like. Some of these are self-induced problems where they don't keep up in the home in some particular fashion. So normally these bugs are creating some sort of overwintering shelter, or it can be temporary, like springtails. They're just coming in during the summer because they're trying to find get away from too much moisture, or they're trying to seek out moisture because it's become too dry. They'll look for food, water, but mostly they're looking for protection from some sort of elemental danger to them, whether it be moisture, it's too hot, too dry, and the like. They will wander into homes. Usually it's accidental, but with some sort of measured purpose. Okay. So what is an overwintering pest exactly? Definition: an adult arthropod that passes through some portion of its life cycle within the structure for purpose of surviving wintering conditions, right? So something to think about. Some of these summertime pests are doing this activity, but typically do it later in the summer, which makes this presentation very timely relative to the fact that, you know, the end of summer is going to be getting upon us as we are midway through. So thinking about this and doing preventative measures is going to be very, very important. Different types of occasional invaders: spiders, mites, ticks, scorpions, millipedes, centipedes, pill bugs, all sorts of oddball insects that we'll get into. Speaking of which, you've got Mormon cricket pictured here, typically an issue in basements and the like. You have a brand new one with Turkestan roaches, which we'll have a picture of if you want to take a look at. But that one's becoming an issue throughout the United States, slowly, not very quickly, but slowly. Crickets, earbugs, ground beetles, springtails, which we've already mentioned. Okay, so this is the Turkestan cockroach. Like I said, it's been moving all over the United States. Initially, it was in Arizona, New York. Now we're finding it scattered throughout the United States. It's becoming more of an issue. But you notice that the females and males are totally of different coloration. Okay, so there's some obviousness to this relative to the other roaches that that we deal with on a regular basis. So it's it can be easy to identify, and it can be difficult if you haven't seen or noticed these before. Okay. All right. So here's another example of the colorations throughout their life cycle. All right. Okay. And that was American cockroach there in the last photo. Sorry. Went through that a little quick. Okay. Other ones typically found in vegetation. Some spiders, obviously, garden spiders, but normally we're not taking control of garden spiders, hopefully. Okay. All sorts of different plant bugs, leaf hoppers and the like, which is why we're going to end up discussing the spotted lanternfly, which is a huge leaf hopper. Some types of ants can cause this issue where they're just associated with vegetation and the like. And then you also see stuff like kudzu bug down in the bottom, which are tremendous issues in the southeast. Occasional invaders that actually fly. So those include all types of different wasps, including ground nesting hornets and the like, cluster flies, you name it. But it just kind of depends on their behaviors, right? All right, so management. What can we do? Well, we can obviously exclude them, which is can be extremely helpful in some situations. But if that's all you're doing, it might not prevent some of the issues outside of the home. And obviously, homeowners are concerned with what's going on outside of their home. So exclusion, great. It's wonderful. But it might not fit the whole picture, as with insecticides. Insecticides might not fit the whole picture. So we might need to do additional things, because we might not be able to get enough product in the right areas in order to prevent their populations. You know, in some cases, we talk about physical removal because they're already inside the structure. So vacuuming and the like is incredibly important in some situations. But we have to remember that we have to do exclusion at the right time as a preventative measure, because occasionally you can be trapping them inside the structure. So you've got to think about timing relative to the biology and their behavior associated with that biology, so that you don't create a further problem for yourself later on down the line. Then a month later, Mr. or Mrs. Jones is calling you for some sort of issue where you've basically barricaded and kept the insects in, say in the spring when they're trying to get out. Okay. So what does the future of these exterior perimeter applications look like? Okay, there's going to continue being these ground and surface water protection issues that EPA is going to bring up. Some of them are going to be well measured. Some states are going to maybe go a little further than maybe they scientifically should. All right. But it's going to keep happening. Government's going to continue to expand those laws. It's just the inertia of things right now. Okay. So we're not going to be able to get away from that. So accepting that and being real with it is going to be incredibly important. So what do we mean? And we look at this landscape and we say, okay, this is pretty standard fare, right? We've got a lot of potential surface area to treat here relative to occasional pests. But if we're treating in some areas, you know, this could be an issue where if you're outside and you're spraying on these landscape areas, where is it potentially going to run off if you use too much product? If there's too much volume and you're not paying attention and you're not moving quickly enough, where is it going to run? Also, additionally, if there are rain events, what's going to be happening to those insecticides? Are they potentially going to adhere to the surface that you're applying, or is there potential for runoff? And this diagram kind of gives you a good example of what can potentially happen relative to the grade of the property that you're on. So we always have to be mindful of what is going on in our surroundings, not just the pest and their behavior that we're looking to conquer, okay? All right, so most structural pest problems originate on the exterior of the structure. So brown marmorated stink bug, for example, are going to be alighting on the outside of a structure. Maybe eventually they're going to come inside, all right? So at some point, the homeowner or the management is going to give you a call and say, hey, we've got X on the outside of the home, typically. Sometimes they're going to be calling you about indoor pests where they've made it already in, and you're going to need to be adjusting your plan. But you can do preventative applications for some of these pests, okay? But doing a really thorough interior inspection, even though they've told you they're only on the outside, you could say, hey, we should probably go ahead and look indoors and see if I can find them, say, up in the attic, and then you can treat accordingly, okay? Treatment doesn't always have to include our products, right? So we could do other things. We could exclude, we could vacuum. You could do a large number of things and create an immediate response for the customer. So ounce of prevention. If we know behaviorally when these pests are going to be coming out, typically year to year, then we can do some prevention. We'll talk about that in some of the data that we've had that we're going to be discussing here in a little bit. Okay. Other thing to think about when applying to these areas. We can do average applications that will take care of most of the pests that we are trying to prevent or trying to cure. Okay. So we think about, how efficient are we going to be? How much product are we going to use, and therefore how much cost? So there's a number of different things to think about, but there's different products that enable you to have a better general idea of what is going to happen relative to causing kill or control of the pests. So obviously Alpine WSG has been one that people have zeroed in on as a reliable occasional pest product that can kill a whole lot of insects really quickly, and it's got a nice broad label. We also talk about Termidor for some of these. Yes, they're nice average applications. We can go onto the structure with both of these products. We can go into usually where these types of of occasional pests are going or coming into the structure, right? So most of the areas are taken care of with these two products, but do we need to get more specific? Well, it depends on the pest, all right? So you can think of it as indoor-outdoor programs, right? We don't always have to stick to just these products either. Yes, they're a nice, they're very nice products to rely upon and to focus on, but sometimes we need to go outside this and move on to other products and get more specific with what we're dealing with. All right, so we also don't want to think about, okay, I'm just using the same product every single time and I can do the same exact thing in every situation. Yeah, that could be the case, but some structures are just built differently. And even with the same exact pest, you're going to need to react in a different way. So we talk about this as becoming the zombie technician, where we're going out and we're doing the same exact thing, and we're trying to move from structure to structure because we've got to get to 14 other stops today. And it's a tough timeline, but I caution you that if you don't always take your time, take a few extra minutes to assess a situation, you could be asking yourself to come back and create a callback issue 2 weeks from now or a month from now or next spring when they start to come out of the structure. So we beg of you to think of the biology and behavior of the insect and match that relative to the different products that you're using and where you're using those. Okay. All right. So we don't want you to become the zombie technician, basically. All right. We don't have any real pictures of that. So. Other things that affect efficacy of products out in the field. The real world is very harsh to insecticides. We don't really talk about that enough. But different types of substrates can create big issues. So if you've got relatively new concrete, that can be very caustic. And there are all sorts of different insecticides that do not do well. There are very few that do well in caustic situations. So brand new concrete is one of those examples. older concrete don't typically have those issues. But at any rate, it's something to think about. In newly built homes, we've got to be mindful of new concrete and realize that on that surface, the product probably isn't going to work as well as we would expect under normal conditions. Susceptibility to UV, the sun. The sun breaks down tons of different insecticides. So it's really important to remember that over time, sun is going to win, period, on every single insecticide out there. Right, there's all sorts of degradation patterns that are created through sunlight. Formulation of the insecticide can affect how well it stays on a particular surface. It can also affect the availability to the insects that are traveling on that surface, whether or not the initial application was done in a thorough fashion, the types of applications. So if we change from, say, a JD9 gun, and from the back of a truck, and then we move to a B&G, our spray pattern is going to be wholly different. Also, the pressure that's created out of those applications is totally different. So if we're looking for more thorough applications, we may need to move to a higher pressure situation rather than go into an average B&G. So keep that in mind. Volume really does affect how well the application is placed. And it also will affect the residual. Time of year of application, if we're starting in the spring versus in the middle of the summer, when the sun is really bright and tremendously available to the surface area, that can greatly affect it on into the fall periods where you have a little bit easier of a time with residual, creating residual. And then also the class of insecticide. We're not gonna get into that too deeply, but just be mindful. Some of those are gonna last on different surfaces better than others, okay? And that's just a simple fact. appetitive types of behaviors. So the natural desire to satisfy bodily needs, insects need it. They're going to need food, shelter. They're going to get away from water. They're going to come to water. So all sorts of different reasons why they are entering into structures. But this is a very basic biological need. They're going to come into a structure. It's just a matter of time, right? But they're trying to optimize their temperature and moisture. And that's really the bottom line. So yeah, they're looking for food and everything, but most of the time when these overwintering pests are coming in or these summer pests are coming in, they're looking for temperature and moisture differences that are specific to their needs at that time. All right, so they can crawl in, they can fly in, they can get in through a void where they might both fly and crawl, okay? All sorts of different places that we can prevent entry into these structures. So exclusion are going to be the focus of these next several pictures, all sorts of different avenues. Definitely always look up. There are all sorts of different holes that we don't think about when we look up into a structure that can really negatively impact the ability of a technician to create a callback-free account, okay? All right, so we're going to start focusing in on the pests. And the first one up is the brown marmorated stink bug. I'm gonna start off with that one because it's nice and established. And maybe we'll get into some tidbits that you didn't know about, or maybe you haven't heard about the brown marmorated stink bug yet. It's all over the country, but it's not everywhere, okay? And we'll talk about the likelihood of where they could end up being as well. So the first example, we had three different types of occasional invaders with this just this one photo where we got brown marmorated stink bug in the middle. It's a dead one, obviously. And then we've got the Asian lady beetle and we have kudzu bug. So three different types on this particular structure, which is, I would imagine, pretty aggravating for them. So first up, we're going to talk about the biology and control of what we can say BMSB, or brown marmorated stink bug. Probably about every third time I say marmorated, I screw it up, so bear with me. I don't know, it's a tongue twister. Okay, where are they at? All right, they started out east and they started moving westward, all right? So about the size of this stink bug that I've got here on the map is about the area in which they are, but they are heading west. Biologically, they're going to make it elsewhere, and they're going to make it elsewhere in pretty decent numbers, depending upon the surrounding areas around the neighborhood, okay? And we'll kind of get into to that reasoning here in a second. But here's the overall map, at least the most recent one I could find. It seems like they'll keep track of these maps really well for the first several years, and then they start not keeping track of them. So we're looking back at 2020, okay? So the states in the red are very severe agricultural pest, okay? Or nuisance problems. So nuisance problems are generally going to become our issue, right? Where they become some sort of annoyance for typically homeowners and sometimes commercial facilities, but not nearly as often. But you can see that practically all the states, they've found them, okay? Doesn't mean that they've become established, but they've found them and then they've become nuisance pests. So, you know, fast forward this to a couple of years later and you've probably got at least a few more yellow and orange areas. California is going to be a pretty serious issue, especially with the agricultural industry. It's going to become a pretty big problem over there, I would suspect. Okay. Moving on into others. So this is the look, right? So it's all mottled or marmorated, all sorts of different patterns. None of them are the same. There's all sorts of the stippling, the dots, and you kind of liken it to different types of marble that you can find, or marble granite. That has this modeling look to it. Okay. So in some cases, they can be this thick. Scattered throughout here, you'll also notice the green stink bug, which is typically an agricultural pest. You never see them in those large numbers around a given home. But in this case, you're probably looking at some structure that is very near a field of some sort of an agricultural product to create, number one, these numbers, and number two, have a green stink bug close enough by that they've started coming to the structure itself. So keep that in mind, all right? Okay, so this is a true bug, and the way you tell is, I'll get out my handy dandy laser pointer here, and is this triangle right here in the back. That's how you know you've got yourself a true bug, and they have elytra, which is a forewing that covers the back, and half of that wing is hard, and half of it is membranous, okay? So you've got yourself a stink bug, which means they're hopping basically from plant to plant, and they've got a proboscis that helps them puncture the plant and then suck out the juices. There's a ton of different species out there. They're never an issue for structural pests, but this one has become a pretty decent sized issue for structural pests. In fact, we had them on the house the last few years. We never had them in great numbers, but we're also not right close to a field, to an agricultural field either. So they can be in small numbers, they could be in huge numbers. They first were discovered about 25 years ago, and they've kind of slowly spread. Here recently, I've noticed that there's been an uptick in the last probably 3 or 4 years from moving much more quickly throughout the map of the US. And pretty simple to identify, although when they're on the plants, they look a little funky in their nymphal stage. But as their adult stage, they're much easier to identify. And even when you have them, when they're dead and they're on their backs, you can still see that stippling on the underside. Now you got to do is just flip it over and make sure you've got it identified. But typically the numbers are going to let you know. All right, so what type of crops are at risk? All sorts of stuff, basically. You've got high risk, medium risk, and low risk, but all sorts of things have become issues. Apple trees, oddball things like eggplants, probably going to be an issue in California. Sweet corn, you name it, they're all over it. And they can be in that way in very high numbers. Okay. For things like apples, they typically just cause damage. Disease has not seemed to be a big of an issue for this particular insect. But I don't think that would be too surprising if they pass some sort of disease at some point that becomes pretty severe, because it just seems to happen with plant bugs. All right. So host plants that are going to be typically closer to suburbia, okay, are going to be things, all sorts of different plants that they will go to, and they will create their life cycle somewhat nearby. So the adult female will lay the eggs, say in soybean, and then the nymphs will go around popping holes in plants and eating and the like. And then the adults come out and then they move to potentially suburbia, all sorts of different plants. They've got aggregation pheromones, so they'll typically start moving to those. From there, they might move to a structure, or they might go directly to the structure from the field. So it just kind of depends. Most of the time, you're talking about one life cycle throughout most of their area, but they could potentially create multiple life cycles, which means that the numbers could become pretty great the farther south you go, right? So what does it look like as far as their life cycle? They'll be in their egg form for about a week, and then they'll move into their different instars. So they will have 4 instars before they get to their last nymphal stage, okay? And that is going to be unlike what we're going to talk about here in a second, the spotted lanternfly, which is a little bit different, OK? Okay, so in this case, we're talking about 5 total nymphal stages, and then they move into their adult, and they live for about a month and a half, give or take. Okay, they don't read books, so they might last longer, but for the most part, this is what you're going to be seeing through the typical areas within the United States. Okay, so in the winter, or coming out of the winter, let's start there. Coming out of the winter, they'll disperse from, say, a structure and move back to the field or maybe even to a plant that is nearby the structure. They'll lay their eggs, and then the nymphal stages will grow. The adults will then coming out of that summertime. Then they'll go to the structure, and typically in the early fall or late summer time period, and then moving on into either death or finding a structure to overwinter in. Okay, so very similar to the spotted lanternfly, which we'll get to here in a minute. All sorts of natural enemies. Clearly, the natural enemies haven't necessarily caught up to them here in the United States. Typically, if you're going to be controlling some sort of population, you're talking about mites or bacteria or virus or something that is going to start controlling these types of insects, especially in large population areas, where it can be a little bit more easy to spread, but not necessarily. But typically, these types of natural enemies are never going to completely control a population. It kind of, it really just, it doesn't happen, okay? Try as they might, it can't get these to happen consistently within the biological industry, okay? All right, so control, we're talking about exclusion, use of vacuums to reduce the numbers, and then we're gonna move to insecticides, okay? So sometimes you may only have enough time for insecticides on a given structure. You're gonna need to explain it. Hey, listen, I'm probably not gonna get everywhere with the insecticides that these bugs are. So they have to keep that in mind, set that expectation for the homeowner, okay? But for the most part, you could really knock down the numbers with insecticide usage, whether it be encapsulated products or some sort of residual. We've got data on that, which I'll show you here in a second. Okay, so we can do non-chemical prevention where we do some sort of exclusion, okay? And we think about, you know, well, how's the structure built? How are they going to be getting into this structure? What has the builder messed up that's going to cause potential entry into a structure, okay? There's all sorts of holes. There's all sorts of new stuff that will attract these occasional invaders, including BMSB, okay? So we're looking at more typically the higher areas for BMSB behaviorally. Okay, so they might be coming in through the roof, but most of the time they're going to be on the siding and coming in through the siding and through the eaves and anywhere there might be holes on the side of the structure. Farther south we go, meaning the farther closer to the ground we go, the less likely they are to behaviorally alight or land on those particular areas and cause some sort of aggregation pheromone that will invite others to also land there, okay? So window units, caulking with piping can be very useful. But like I said, the farther or closer to the ground you go, the less likely it is behaviorally to become an issue for brown marmorated stink bugs. Always hold excluding in these particular areas, but yet still allowing the house to breathe is really important. Yes, you can do stink bug traps, right? They work really well, but it's just like a mosquito light. If you want to control mosquitoes, you give mosquito light to your neighbors. So you invite them to go over. So you're asking for trouble anytime you use these close to a structure because you're inviting them in from longer distances. And so, caution, be very judicious with this type of control apparatus that you don't cause more problems than you wish to. Thought I had another picture of one. These are some of the traps that people have started to invent for BMSB. And you'll notice that this trap is very simplistic. You just let them come into a void and they like that void, okay? But how many people are gonna be putting these up? Not very many, right? So these are the types of voids that they like. They like to be kind of tactic, where they like to have touching on all sides and the like, at least initially, and they might go move to some more open areas, kind of like cluster flies do. Here's another example of a pheromone trap, and this is actually a visual trap that could be changed into a pheromone trap if necessary. But visual, they're attracted to the yellow and the black. So if you've got a yellow painted house, you may have some problems, right? But you may have some problems with some other bugs too. Okay, here are the results that Rutgers University looked at a few years ago. And they looked at and aged out these products and looked at applying to the material. In this case that we've got here right now is painted wood. And then they hung them vertically outside of a structure, just like you would underneath the eave. So they would have sunlight degradation, potential rain would be brought upon these. And then they brought them into the lab in order to complete the project. So they aged the surfaces outdoors and then forced the BMSB adults onto these surfaces. So you could see the results here comparing alpine and Aralon, and then the control mortality at day zero. You've got pretty high mortality with alpine WSG compared to Aralon, and at 7 days out aging process, you've got 100% versus 53%, and then 2 weeks out, you've got a pretty decent amount of control still with alpine, but it starts to wane. And probably the biggest reason why is that these are bigger bodied insects, and so it just takes more material. So if you've got enough material degrading over time, that's not too greatly unexpected. And also you're dealing with painted wood. These were aged painted wood, but to a point, paint has an issue anytime you've got somewhat fresh paint, you know, say within a year of applying the material, you've still got some sort of lack of bioavailability where the insecticide will adhere to the paint. So in this case, the painted wood was not aged for very long. It was aged only a couple of months. So, you know, in that case, you're not taking away all of the potential for the paint to hold on to the insecticide. But that is it's a real thing, and it can confuse a lot of people as to why they're not getting results on certain surfaces. And paint is a pretty big issue. And there's all sorts of different paints out there. You practically do a whole lecture on that alone. Here are the results from the polyvinyl testing. Again, these were aged anywhere from 0 to 2 weeks out. And you can notice again that there's a pretty discernible difference between alpine and Aralon. Better results with polyvinyl siding, not surprising, because it's a less absorptive surface. And you don't also have that the paint holding on to the insecticide as well. Pretty good results. So you could expect, okay, I can have 2 weeks of residual on, say, polyvinyl siding, or at least a week out with painted wood. And maybe if I know the timing of the typical adults coming out, then we can predict that, and we can go out and do preventative applications on some of these structures that have had issues in the past, in the previous years. So you can take that behavioral knowledge and you can potentially do preventative applications and do pretty well with it. So something to contemplate with BMSB. Okay, so what does the future of BMSB management look like? You can expect them to go away at some point, but they're gonna rebound their populations. Usually this happens with newly invading populations of insects, where eventually the populations will decrease over time. And usually that's because of some sort of bacteria or mite or a virus issue, and it starts to crash the populations, but invariably they come back up. And so they'll go over a roller coaster of time. But usually that happens over a kind of a several year period, okay? They're gonna acquire different predators and the like. Kind of mentioned that with the biological organisms, but eventually some of these are gonna have some sort of measure of impact. But again, overall, these don't really cause, these type of predators, parasites don't normally cause enough damage to a population to have a legitimate effect. Typically it's the biological organisms that are the key. So again, exclusion, chemical control are the keys to the management right now with BMSB. It's good business. Take advantage of it while you're on the upside of the roller coaster as opposed to the downside when the populations start crashing eventually, okay? All right, next up, new kid on the block, the spotted lanternfly. This is a very curious sucker and seems to be moving more quickly than BMSB did initially. We'll kind of get into that here in the next few minutes. So what the heck is it? Spotted lanternfly, I mentioned earlier, it's a true bug, okay? So again, you notice the triangle on the back, okay? All right, and they're most well known and their adult form for their coloration and spotting. They're very easy to recognize. There's nothing else out there that looks like these. Nothing else out there that acts like these. They're really kind of a pretty insect. But man, are their numbers crazy in some situations. Most of the time for structural pests, we're gonna be dealing with them on the trees and sometimes on structures. Commercial structures have become a real issue, especially in ports. It's become a huge issue. So neighborhoods are still gonna have some issues, but mostly they're gonna be on the trees. They're not going to act completely like BMSB, where they're looking to find some sort of protection, okay? This is an old map. Again, they don't always keep remaking these maps, but since this point in time, from several years ago, was when they initially invaded the US in the probably the Philly area, close to the port, no surprise. You've got a creation over the next like 5 years-ish, this particular map, all right? And so that's actually moving pretty quickly to not only find them in these counties, but have them established in these counties. That's pretty darn quick. Now we've started seeing them in Ohio established. So they're moving pretty quick. And then also they found them in Kansas randomly. How, you know, they haven't found an established population yet in Kansas, but it will not surprise me. They are causing tremendous issues to some of the commodities businesses, especially within Pennsylvania. The grape industry is really, really fearful within Pennsylvania. Smucker's has a big outfit within Pennsylvania where they grow their jam grapes. And so they're extremely fearful because they will attack all sorts of different commodity crops. So anyhow, they have very long distance dispersal. And like I said, this map is not representative. It has gone elsewhere in at least a few other states. So keep that in mind, and they're moving pretty quick. So this is definitely one to pay attention to. This is what they look like out in the field. When they are creating egg masses that you see on the left, they're pretty well grayed out. They look cracked. They don't look like they should have anything that's surviving inside of them, but they do. And the interesting aspect is that very recently they studied the outside of the layer of the egg mass and found that it is protein coated, which is kind of somewhat dissimilar to the typical lipid layer that is placed upon the outside of the structure of some of these egg masses from other insects. But this one is very much protein-based. And so as a result, they've had a lot of issues spraying some of these egg masses. And so that'll be really interesting. They recently looked at some of our aerosols that had really good success on these egg masses, whereas some of the liquid insecticides have not found any penetrative type of capabilities. Okay, so moving to the middle picture, the early instar nymph, this is what they look like. So they've got three different instars at this stage. They move on to the fourth instar, which is the picture on the right, and that's when the coloration begins, is that last stage prior to becoming an adult. The adult form, when their wings are closed, look kind of almost pinkish with those black dots and the venation at the aft end of the elytra, okay? And then when they open up their wings, the secondary wings have that reddish coloration, and they're really obviously pretty neat, all right? So what does their life cycle look like? Okay, they create their egg masses. Depending on where on the map you are, the farther south you go, the more likely you are to find them earlier in the season. Okay, so anywhere from going backwards to September to June timeframe, you'll find the egg masses. Then they'll hatch out, and then they'll move through their different instars. And those instars, the late instar will start to pop up in anywhere from July to September. When they did their study last year for some of the products out there, the late instar was occurring in late July or early July, and then they start moving into the adult stage late July, early August, at least that was last year. So every year is going to be slightly different, just a measure of how much different is going to be, because weather's different every single year, right? So then the adults are out the last half of the year, and they're surviving for a pretty good while until it becomes a very hard freeze and they overwinter within the egg masses, okay? Adults as yet, not overwintering, but not going to be surprising if the farther south they move, that the more likely they are to overwinter as adults, which could then become an even bigger issue population-wise. All right, so what's their pest status? They are huge agriculture ornamental type pest. They'll feed on the sap of pretty much everything, very much like brown maroon stink bug. They'll be found in huge numbers on the trunk. So clearly they have an aggregation pheromone, just like the stink bugs, where they'll come out in these large numbers. They don't bite, they don't sting. So people are afraid of that. Well, you know people. They don't typically kill the plants, but they do stress them out. Right now, the management process has become scraping the egg masses from the trees. Hopefully now with some of these newer data with the aerosols, they have penetrative access to the egg mass. They can begin doing it a little bit easier and a little bit more thorough as far as killing the egg stage. They'll occasionally put bands around the trees, sticky bands and the like. And yeah, that can hold a fair number of them, maybe prevent them hopefully from creating new egg masses. But that's not really going to be an end all be all type of control effort. It's just hoping to control the population in that particular area a little bit better. They're starting to remove the preferred host. Good luck with that. That's only going to be probably in government controlled areas that they're able to do that, because I don't think homeowners are going to be giving up their plants anytime soon. And then they move to insecticide use. So we're going to start talking about that. All right. So we see here the setup of a research protocol that Penn State Extension looked at with spotted lanternfly. They looked at Alpine WSG, and then also attaining label data for Redesco, new pesticides likely to come out next year. And so you can see here within this video is actually taken from New Jersey at a commercial facility. And so they even found some somewhat decent numbers, I would say sparse numbers for obvious reasoning, at a commercial facility. So commercial facilities are not out of the question for invasions. Okay, so what did they find? It looked at third and fourth instar on vinyl siding and had some pretty good results. Alpine Redesco out at 72 hours had 100% control, 2 weeks, 100% control. So hey, you know what? We know we can get 2 weeks out of these things. So we've got some pretty good control measures, much similar to the BMSB. And then at 3 weeks, we start to see a drop off in the residual ability of some of these products. You know, again, you're typically dealing with bigger bodied insects, even though you're dealing with third and fourth instars. These are, you know, bigger than most insects on average, right? Adult spotted lanternfly, again, on vinyl siding, and you've got pretty good control week out. 3 weeks out, you start to see some waning of control again. All right, back to fourth instar this time, but on the tree of heaven. So take these plants, put them into the greenhouse, and they really like tree of heaven. So if anybody's got tree of heaven, you're gonna get some spotted lanternfly when they come into your neighborhood. Both Alpine and Redesco did pretty well the first couple of weeks, and then start to wane some of the control at 4 weeks out. So we've got some pretty reliable control depending on the stage of the insect, anywhere from, you know, 1 to 2 weeks out. And then you've still got some measure of control the farther out we go. And that's really actually pretty good on some of these, you know, larger bodied insects. So some of the recommendations that Penn State has compiled, you know, obviously we may end up needing in our industry lawn licensing to do some of the applications, because some of them are further up the tree rather than on the bole of the tree, which is still within our purview, right? But once you start needing to apply to the whole tree, we need to start thinking about different licensing and the like, okay? Just kind of depends on what you've got, what you're using, and what your licensing is in your particular state. Obviously, the different types of products that are available, none of which have them listed specifically on it. You've got some emergency use exemptions, but I don't know that there's any data on those because to our knowledge, we are the first ones to get any data on SLF. Penn State Extension's planning a further insecticide protocols and experiments. They've got some ideas on a number of different other products that might be out there for some other avenues for them. So that'll be really interesting in the future as to whether or not they can make that happen. But Penn State is a real leader. Another one is Virginia Tech, which started looking at it after Penn State. But for the most part, Penn State seems to be leading that effort with obvious reasoning. All right, so we're gonna go over a quick data set here on spiders, which are for many people considered occasional pests, especially when they are dealing with the outdoor spiders, okay, as opposed to indoor. And then we were gonna open this sucker up for questions. This is an old one. And this is one we don't talk about very often, which is Termidor, and Termidor's ability on spiders to control them. This was done at a commercial facility, as you can see here, on web spinning spiders on eaves within this particular structure. And we'll show you some pictures here in a minute. So you can see some of the setup. They retreat from light to light and the different different areas that were treated or left untreated completely. You can see here, pre-testing, okay, what does the site look like? There are two different sites, we're gonna call them alpha and beta, okay? And so you can see, you know, pretty fair amount of spiders in this particular case on these eaves. And then you can look at some of these data, okay? The top two lines are the alpha site, the alpha application, and then the alpha control. And then the bottom two lines are the beta site and beta control, okay? So using my pointer here, maybe I'll switch here to the pen. All right, so we've got the alpha side, and then we've got the beta side, okay? So at any one point, we are talking about how many spiders are living, okay, on this particular area of treatment. In this case, we've got 65 on the treated site for alpha, and then 134 on the control. And so what they did for control was they knocked down all the spiders and then sprayed material, okay? So in every situation, we see a big drop off a few days out. That's great, to be expected, pretty normal, okay? So when we move over here, and then we move over here, we start to see some of the effects of the application, especially when we move out to the 1 month out, okay? Knocking down spiders, it's okay for a month, but then these numbers start really rebounding in these non-treated areas. So you can see here, we go from this, from the 1 week out to the 30 days out, and you've got a huge amount of spiders being created in this situation. You see it here again in the controls, okay? So we can really greatly reduce by applying certain types of material, in this case, Terminator applications. And this holds true all the way out through, through 90 days, where you've got a tremendous reduction in the treated areas, okay? So we don't always talk about Terminator, but goodness, it's actually a pretty good spider control product. Every single spider out there, maybe not, but it's got pretty good control for some of these outdoor spiders. We just don't talk about it very often. So you can see here an example, 30 days out on the alpha site, where you've got control on the left and Terminator applications on the right, and you can see that it is extremely clean on the Terminator applications. Again, here's a beta site example. This one's 2 months out, control on the left, and Terminator on the right. And you can just see just a few spiders hanging out and able to live. So with that, I will end this program. And I will remind you to please steward our products carefully. Reading the label, and reading it thoroughly and knowing your label inside and out is a difficult job, because you've got lots of different products that you use. But goodness, it can save you a lot of headaches in the long run by just knowing and understanding the label. If you have any questions, you can always call into us and ask us to find out what our interpretation is of some of these labels. And do not be afraid to talk to your state representatives or your state regulatory representatives. Most of them are extremely helpful and just simply want you to be better educated. You know, you've got a few bad eggs, but you got a few bad eggs everywhere. So, I really do urge you to talk to your state representatives. There's some really good people out there, and they're more than willing to help you out interpret some of these labels. So don't be shy, ask questions, okay? All right, Lisa. Do we have any questions? Jeff?
Yes, and I can start with this one over here. This is, how can you elaborate, on how different types of formulation affect products' residual?
So some of them are pretty obvious. Some of them are not obvious. Encapsulation, for example, is an obvious one where you can have protection, potential protection from UV light source with the encapsulation. You can also have potential protection depending on the active ingredient and how it's formulated, how well it interacts with the inert ingredients, how well it stays onto a particular surface. All those things can really greatly affect it. Also dispersion of materials, whether you're talking about aerosols, and this is kind of less likely and less obvious, but it's a physical reasoning where you can create much broader applications and create more bioavailability with the finer the material is spread out onto a surface. And a lot of aerosols will do that. So it'll become a physical application difference between that and say a liquid application, which can start to dry up, and they dry up in these puddles. And then those puddles are created little spots of active ingredient that's left behind. Okay. And so there's a large number of things that formulations can do. Different formulations can create very obvious scenarios. And then there's obviously the unobvious ones that you don't normally think about.
Right. Next question. I have, what's the active ingredient in Alpine?
Alpine is dinotefuran. So that is a neonicotinoid. And it's a subclass nitroguanidine. So it's a separate subclass than the other neonics out there. So it actually acts quite a bit differently within the insect and on surfaces than does other neonicotinoids.
What aerosol was used for the egg masses for spotted lanternflies? Some products officially have them on their label.
I would be surprised if they have them on the listed on the label, but that study is not out yet. They did tell me the results, which is pretty interesting. So I'm going to wait and let them say which products they used. But there were two or three of them that actually worked pretty well. I'm going to let Penn State come out with that one, because they didn't do a full and complete study. They did an initial study to find out what they thought they'd be able to find. So I'm going to wait on that, but it looks pretty good, and it looks way better than what they've been doing. The results are demonstrably better.
All right. What do you recommend for spiders on pool cages for spiders?
On what cages?
Pool cages?
Pool cages. Oh, I got you now. Okay. That's a really good question, because, you know, invariably you're going to have some sort of fallout onto the area because you're spraying up, directly up. That's pretty interesting. So I don't know how to answer that question. I know there are some nettings out there that have insecticides on them. They're not necessarily impregnated inside of them, so they're not necessarily protected either. Those that I am aware of that are commercially available on the screens are available on the outside, so they can become degraded by the sun quite easily because they're on the outside of that netting. But I think you have to be careful about the application process on that netting, and you may need to focus primarily on the metal frame, possibly. I honestly don't have very good experience with those pool cages like they do down in Florida. Maybe Bob Davis might have that notice. He might be on here. He might be able to type in an answer.
Right. And let's see if we get that. And if not, we can go back to that. We also have here, should we also be using glue boards on BMSB?
Yeah, I mean, maybe if they get into the attics, maybe, but I don't know if they're attracted to them, and I don't know if you can put out enough, honestly, in those type of situations. They'd be a tough one for glue boards, I think. It's a good thought, but I just don't, I don't know where you would put them to get exactly where you want them to go, unless, you know, unless you can find them in an attic. In that case, I would recommend you probably vacuum them up as opposed to put out a glue board. That's a difficult answer for me as well.
Right. Any thoughts on using IGR with Alpine WSG? And if so, what type?
Okay, so our standing on this is that depends on the insect. And it's never going to interfere with Alpine or any of our other non-repellents. IGRs are non-repellent. Okay, so we don't mind if you use it. It might be overkill in some situations. It just kind of depends, but it's not normally going to hurt your situation by using it. There's a lot of different thought. A lot of the recent thought came out from Dr. Potter before he retired on bed bugs, and he was pretty insistent that it didn't work as far as population control goes. But again, you're not going to hurt your situation by using IGRs. So again, it just kind of depends. But BMSB and spotted lanternfly, I'm not aware of any IGR studies being conducted. But most of the time, as far as life stage goes, when they're on or in the house or structure, they're going to be in the adult form. Take that for what you will. You're gonna have to go out to the field to really affect the populations away from the structure. Jeff,
here, does BASF have a plan on going after more insects in the lawn and ornamental for Alpine WSG, and do they plan on applying for basal application label?
Yeah, so that's a fine question. I'll answer it, and I'll let Jeff go after it as well. So we're looking at more things, more items to add to some of the labels. Alpine's on some of the projects that we're looking at. Some of the other products are what we're also looking at more specifically. So we're always going to try and expand the labels, just whether or not it's strategic enough to do that. I think it would work mightily well on some of these lawn pests. But we may not have all of those data available for that type of 2EE response in the current. So if it's not on the label, do we have the data? Some insects we do, but for the most part on lawn and pest, or lawn, we do not. But we've got a few oddballs that are still not necessarily listed on the label. But anyhow, as far as a concerted effort goes, the answer is both yes and no. Jeff, you want to take that?
Yeah, I mean, I agree. I think your answer is spot on. We try to reach as many problems as we can within the scope of our products and always look for different expansions. We also have a lot of things in development. So I think that one way or another, we target, we spread our solutions, but we don't have anything specific in mind for Alpine to that application. And well, let's then you also made a lot of emphasis on UV degradation of insecticides. Mm-hmm. So given that most applications are outdoors during the day, what are best practices to avoid that becoming a problem?
Simple. You can't avoid it. You're gonna have to, you gotta take the sun full on. If you've got an area you need to treat, you've got to treat it. You know, some products, you know, say that they've got, you know, UV degradation prevention. Some of that's legitimate. Some of it's maybe not so. But it's just something that is going to have to be accepted that photolysis from the sunlight is going to happen. And avoiding it is, frankly, inevitable.
All right. Those are
good question. I wish I could answer that, though.
Yeah. Better. But. So those are all the questions that we have. And well, with that said, I don't know if you have anything to add to that. To any more comments regarding your presentation?
Hey, you know, just think about some of the products that are on sale right now that have a fit for these occasional pests. There's a pretty decent number that we've got that are on sale currently. So think about those relative to these occasional pests, because I mean, they're, you know, if you could, this is kind of like ants. If you can prove, you know, that you can control these occasional oddball pests, and you can really prove to that homeowner, that management, that you can solve a wide variety of issues, and they'll have a little bit more faith in you. But there's a pretty decent number of products that we've got on sale right now that fit this profile quite well.
All right. Here we have one more. In your experience, what are some products that have legitimate UV degradation prevention?
I know encapsulations, I know we've got some UV degradation prevention with Fedona CS. You know, does that mean, oh, it's going to last a year? No, of course not. But it can slow down that process. It's a real good question. A lot of the, you know, some of the products will say it, and then we don't really see the data that backs that up. So the UV degradation is a very difficult thing to get past and to demonstrate that longevity of efficacy. Sunlight is a beast.
All right, so I'll take this next one. It's how can I access this recording presentation on slide deck? You're going to receive a link after this presentation on an email. So I think those are all the questions that we have. Well, again, thanks everyone for joining today. And thank you, Jason, for this great presentation that you just gave us. Like you said, there's a reminder that there's a promo ongoing on to the end of this month. And well, again, thanks everyone, and have a great rest of your day.
Bye, everybody. Have a great day.